Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our panel, which is called The Credit Market Outlook. Now, I'm going to put someone on the spot right from the start, because we had a bit of a discussion about what this panel should be called about 5 minutes ago. So he's had about 5 minutes to come up with a new title. Paul?
Well,
still thinking?
I guess we're surprised with the name, and Credit Market Outlook, that sounds, you know, pretty boring. So I thought maybe a better name, I didn't actually know you were really going to put me on the spot, but, how to make money in a zero-rate environment, because I think that's really the thing that all of us are trying to answer. So I think you should change it to how to make money in a zero-rate environment.
Changed. Consider it changed. We've got a new title for our panel. Paul Haworth is with us today, Orchard Global. I have Christopher Lee here from S&P Global, Cheyenne Maheswari from SSG Capital, and Rob Petty at the end here, Clearwater Capital. I'm not going to tell you much about these gentlemen. I'm sure that you've seen their bios, and if you haven't, you all have access to the internet. So we're going to go straight into it. I mean, we're obviously talking about the credit markets. We're talking about how to make money in markets like these. Yield is very, very difficult to find at this point, obviously. And there are now a lot of questions being asked about central banks and how far their policies can go. So let's kick things off here today. Paul, I'm going to start with you. And I want to know from you gentlemen here today whether you think that we are right now at an inflection point when it comes to these markets that we're in right now. Paul.
Well, I guess that's a short-term and a long-term question. And I think that, you know, we may or may not probably not be at a short-term inflection point. But I think in the long term, we're in the middle of a very, 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 very big inflection point. And I think one of the reasons why I thought we should change the name of the panel is that before you can have a credit market outlook, you have to have sort of a global macro outlook. And we can back into what our credit market outlook is. And to speak to this bigger picture inflection point, which has been going on now, I think, for the better part of the last decade, actually, and probably will continue to be an inflection point for the better part of the coming decade, you have to sort of establish what your global macro view is. And ours is very much, I could give you the long version, or I could just cheat by saying that we believe in the Larry Summers view of the world. I guess we're competing against some secret invitation-only sort of Japan panel, so I'd be interested to hear, after it got translated, what goes on there. Thank God these things are on YouTube, so I can go look at it later on. Although I don't know if they put the secret private ones on there. But to quote Larry Summers, as I often find myself doing, I think globally this point of inflection that we're in is we are in the Japanification of the developed world plus China. So I know we have some outliers who are going to fly against that, and I'm interested to have that conversation. But if you stay away from places like India and what may or may not have happened in the Brazil recovery, we do have a model for what we think the global financial markets and indeed credit markets will look like for the better part of the next decade. And in this Larry Summers view of the world, you worry much more about deflation than you do inflation. Something that I haven't actually looked into the components, but the SocGen deflation index, whatever that means, is at an all-time high. And if you believe that, which we do, then your outlook for global growth is going to bounce between negative 50 basis points and positive 2% for the next decade. And if you believe all those things, which we do, then yes, we are at a point of inflection. Unfortunately, that point of inflection doesn't necessarily speak well for a lot of the non-credit instruments that are out there. If you really believe that global growth is going to be less than 2%, then most public equities are mispriced. Most private equities are mispriced, and probably most real estate is mispriced. So the point of inflection that hasn't happened yet, and I think will be a very ugly point of inflection when it does happen, is when those markets that fundamentally right now are pricing a 3 to 4% global growth. Why? Because that's what it's been for the last 30 years. the point of inflection that will be potentially more grisly than the 08 sort of correction will be when those markets realize that 0 to 2% growth is the order of the day and not 3 to 4% growth.
Okay. Rob, let me bring you in here. Do you think that we're going to see something that's far more grisly, to use Paul's words, that we did in 2008?
No.
Okay.
Fundamentally, it's not more grisly. We have learned our lessons, but you do need to be nimble. You do need to be with experienced managers that have war wounds, that have lived through grisly, because there are real difficulties and dangers in the credit markets. The way we model it and the way we think about it, we're Asia-only dedicated people at Clearwater. We actually think there are two inflection points to your first question. Mm-hmm. And the inflection point is really that the global asset allocators are finally ready, two or three decades in, to increase their allocation in a substantial material way to Asia. Because the money managers of Asia are now in their second decade of maturity. More importantly, the markets of Asia, believe it or not, have outperformed in credit for the past 10 years, both U.S. and Europe, and people are now acknowledging and recognizing that fact. And honestly, the opportunity set, where is it going to be grisly? The opportunity set is Asia today. If it first went post-GFC to the U.S., and we cleaned up balance sheets and created non-bank lending, and then we went to Europe, and we cleaned up and are still cleaning up balance sheets there and went to non-bank lending, where are we in Asia? We grew balance sheets in Asia over the past 8 years, right? Today, we're at $37 trillion of total debt. That number has doubled in the past 5 years. So where can it be opportunistic and where are there great opportunities? Asia is the place to be. But there are managers, and relatively few of them, that can take advantage of that. So what are the two areas to do it? You want to go buy assets off the banks, just as we all have seen and practiced in the U.S. and Europe, and you want to replace them and be non-bank lenders, just as we have seen in the U.S. So it's not, I would argue, hard to see the two inflection points, asset allocation to Asia and actually practicing in Asia credit. What it's hard to find is people that can execute.
And what is the catalyst for that?
It's happened already, right? The same catalyst you have in the Western world, right? You have Basel III. You have NPLs in China, pick your balance sheet, and Chris will welcome your numbers, but it's, we'd say, you know, well over 6, 7% of balance sheet. In India, it's substantial. So you have the catalyst for Basel III. We have bank balance sheet problems. They're state-owned banking systems. State-owned banking systems need to shrink, and you need to get alternative lenders in there, or you need to get more credit cuts. The catalysts are here.
I think the only difference I have on this thought process is because they are state-owned banks and their policy statement of the governments. It's they may be defensive today because the balance sheet is looks heavy on the NPL and maybe not reflective in China yet. But on the other hand, as economic recovery kind of comes back, I think the bank balance sheet will be becoming healthier with the more injection from the government as they can afford, which various stages of their evolution. And effectively, because it's policy driven, again it fuels into the growth. So the capex cycle is a lot driven by the banking system than the alternative. By definition, the non-bank or the alternative have to remain alternative and cannot come into mainstream. But so far, as of now, there is an opportunity of next 3, 4, 5 years where the incremental growth will be in the non-bank than the bank. There is an opportunity set.
Specifically India?
India and China both, actually. In China, again, I was talking before with my colleagues as well. There has been haves and have-nots. Some people get credit, even though there is decent liquidity. And some sectors and some companies don't get credit. Mm-hmm. While in India, for sure, it is a macro issue where the banks are not lending at all. And therefore, any growth opportunity, buyout, acquisition, growth, capex, has to be funded from non-bank for the time being.
Mm-hmm. Chris?
I think it just come back to Robert's point about non-bank channels for funding. I mean, in China, we have seen just an explosion in terms of alternative funding channels. Mm-hmm. Whether it's trust funding a few years back, or the you know what they now call the non-bank, or the shadow banking sort of sources of funding, or more recently these cloud funding, peer-to-peer lending. So It has, you know, increased tremendously. It's just that they're not capturing the numbers quite.
There's no transparency, is there, when it comes to those type of markets?
Very little transparency, and it's very little, very hard for us to follow as well, because, you know, without data, it's very hard for us to understand the quality of the assets as well as the performance of those assets. But this is one area that will grow. The big question is, even if, you know, non-performing loan increases in China, whether the banks are happy to let them go, or are they just going to parcel them into or sell them into these state-owned asset companies? We have seen that that play before, you know, 10, 15 years ago. So whether, you know, these sort of loans will be traded, they'll be sold to third-party players, that's an open question. I don't have an answer to that, but I suspect that that market will grow, just like we have seen with trusts and also trust receipts.
Yeah, I guess I have a question maybe for all three of you, which also speaks to our bias. So Orchard is a global manager. It's based in Singapore, but it's a global manager. So we can allocate assets to Asia, to Europe, and to the U.S. as we see fit. And by the way, in the last 10 years, we have gone as high as 85% Asia, probably much less than now, and that is the source of my question. As enthusiastic as everybody else seems to be here on Asia and Asian growth, I want to take two or three things that you guys have said and put it into a question and make sure my goal is to quote Larry Summers as much as possible on this.
I'll count.
And I haven't fact-checked Larry Summers on this, what I'm about to say, but he has written it in the FT, so let's assume that he's right, and I think he is. The Chinese put more steel and concrete, according to Larry Summers, into the ground in between 2011 and 2014 than the U.S. did in the entire 20th century. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's an interesting fact. There is now a transition going on in China and Greater China, and we know what it is, and we don't need to rehash that. And that transition may indeed take China and the rest of the world with it in the right way. But as we all know, when you go through transitions, there's turbulence. And so if we agree that there's going to be this turbulence, the question I have for this incredible sort of pro-Asia sort of camp over here is, if the fundamental sources of credit right now are state-owned banks, you know, this high-yield money market trust kind of thing that is very scary, and peer-to-peer lending, I look at those three decision makers in credit, and I get very worried. Because I don't think that those people have done the good hard work that, you know, the Golubs and the Apollos and the Golden Trees and all the other sort of very intelligent sponsors of this conference have done in the way, I just don't see it. So when that transition happens, and I don't know, the copper suppliers and industrials are becoming less important, and you know, I don't know, consumer, you know, milk producers are becoming more important. How does that point of inflection happen? How does that change happen without actually quite a grisly correction like you saw in the other two markets?
What I'm just trying to say is I totally hear all those points. It is here now in Asia. We're just not as granular as we should be. We have over 10% NPLs in India. You can buy. Our gentleman from BC was talking, it's all about entry price. When you have a high percentage of NPLs, which are here today, you can buy bank loans in Asia at substantially deeper discounts with real hard assets right now. And you can't do that in the Western world. That's more my point. I love the fact that peer-to-peer guys are helping and solve the consumer problem in China because the consumer needs money there. I have no interest in those assets. But I absolutely have interest in infrastructure projects, real estate loans to developers who no longer can get money at a 50% loan to value when I can do that at 20%, which you can do all day long today. It's an entry price point.
So turn it into this. You know, when Mike Milken said this morning, he said when it comes to banks and when it comes to financials, the true competitors in the time to come is going to be the Tencents of this world. It's not going to be the banks. They're not going to be competitors to each other anymore because it's the Tencents and the Alibabas that are going to come and take that place. Are you interested in those assets?
No. Honestly, I have great respect for Tencent and Alibaba, and I think for the consumer, they are going to win, and they are winning, right? But when you go from the real middle market companies in China, of which there's a vast number of successful ones, there is a tremendous amount of opportunity in those guys where the state banks are pulling out, and they're only lending to state banks. There's a wonderful array of private companies across China, and there there's opportunity.
I think also the Tencents or any of such companies which are peer-to-peer, it's all about statistics. So when so far it is granular and similar, I think it works. When it becomes large and bespoke, I think the model will fail. And that is
the model will fail.
That is exactly, yes. And that is where we are talking about corporates, individual large corporates, which cannot get funding from platforms because size will be too difficult to absorb. And the analytics of automation won't work. It has to come back into the picture, the experience and the history, because a lot of these companies have a history. Like, one can look at the metric and say, oh, okay, this company looks good, but when you see the history of 98 all the way till here, you may not want to touch it at 2x EBITDA, while on the other hand, you are willing to touch a company at 6x and still it works. So that part, the intelligence, will take time to build. And that's where I see that granular, small lending, fine, works. But large lending, large loans, still.
Yeah,
still,
but I mean,
fill the juries out.
Again, not to sort of throw water on this kind of raging fire.
But a little
kind
bit.
Of, actually, to throw water on this raging fire. I mean, we've seen this movie before. I'm sorry. Like, securitization is a good thing, fine, when done in the right sort of aligned ways. But history has shown us, you know, and the biggest offenders of this, by the way, are the Americans, or were the Americans, that when you start moving the lender away from the borrower and they're not sort of looking each other in the eyes, that's when you get into trouble. When a Shinto temple in Japan or a water authority in Australia is actually the one who is lending to a house in Merced, California, that you know, to an illegal alien who doesn't actually have a residency or doesn't have an income but wrote it down on a piece of paper and claimed they did, on a house, you talk about loan to values, on a house that's gone up 400% in the last 3 years, that's when you start to see problems. And I'm, you know, maybe I'm just really old-fashioned and I'm not, you know, sort of all about the blockchain and all that fintech and all that wonderful stuff, but I don't see how peer-to-peer lending is, whether it's in Asia or anywhere else, is very different than subprime. I don't see that. And you're right, maybe on a very granular sort of pool of, you know, but once you get into, forget about large corporates, even in medium-sized companies, the reason why Lawrence Golub has been able to build this sort of big empire, and by the way, I agree with him, justifies the fees that he charges, is because he has like 125 people looking after the revolvers. And he has people who are actually looking into the eyes of these borrowers. And I don't see the trust banks doing that. I don't see the peer-to-peer doing that. And sadly, I don't see, I'm a big pro-bank person, but I'm not a pro sort of Asian state-owned bank. And I'm not saying that you can't, with your billion or 10 billion or 20 billion that you grow to, can't find opportunities. But if you look at the sort of Asian continent as a whole, that transition, I think, is going to be a tough one, because I think in many ways we are sort of just recreating subprime here in Asia. So you're right, the numbers of debt have grown. I think you were saying that was a good thing. I actually see it as quite a worrying thing.
Well, let's get Chris to put on his S&P ratings hat on and tell us, what do you think?
Well, the credit quality of these structures, whether it's trusts, loans, or more recently these sort of off-balance sheet banks are lending, the quality, the fact that they have to go off, to go into the shadow banking channels, means that the credit quality tends to be quite weak. So I would agree, you know, in terms of protection, these are very low-quality stuff. I think so far peer-to-peer as a percentage doesn't seem very large. The ones that I've seen successful, for example, like Ant's Financials, where it's a sort of a working capital loan for customers or for suppliers that, you know, the platform is working with, they have a lot of information to assess the business position and also the financing position of these borrowers. So, and it's for a very short period of time. So in terms of control, and the platform has the collateral. So I think that sort of give...
So peer-to-peer is small, but Trust Bank is actually quite a large...
Quite a large, and they have collateral as well.
Would you draw the line between that and what's happening there and subprime?
I think it's very different because there are no tranching. You have just one lender, and you own the assets. And the in terms of supervise, you know, control and estimating the cash flow and also the recovery, I think there are, you know, the trust banks have people to do that. I don't think it's a case where the borrower and the lender don't see each other. I think in China you do see each other quite a bit. And you know, in the sense of a state-owned enterprise, in fact, the party and you know the regulatory agency are also involved. So I think there's multi-levels of control.
So let me jump in here, just because Paul is goading me, and so I'll take the.
I'm glad that you two are on either ends of the panel, here, by the way.
Should have seen last year's panel. You can look it on YouTube.
We fundamentally agree that growth in debt creates opportunity. My point is that where we are in the cycle of addressing that in China and India is NPLs are being recognized and have been recognized. We had a very tough RBI governor who did a very painful job in India but made big companies and big banks address their NPLs so that it's public information over 11% NPLs. So when you have that, now is the time. Where I would disagree with you, because we've had the growth of credit, it is 2 years into the cycle, and you can buy portfolios in India, and you can buy individual credits when you want to at the right price. So a distressed cycle is here. It's not coming. It's arrived. So let me finish. And the same holds true in China, right, that we have acknowledged NPLs and special mention loans, which are 5.8% of bank balance sheets. So you can go in China if you have a dedicated team and you have 100% foreign control. We have a $3 billion balance sheet in China that's been lending there for 5 years, right? ROEs of that business, 2x levered, just like a non-bank finance, no defaults, right? 20% ROEs. So you can do deals, you can make money, and I would fundamentally disagree with your Western perception of where it is. It's already in the addressing time, the time to be thinking about it and recognize Asia learned and has been through multiple cycles. It's not like Asia hasn't learned this. 2098, 18 years, there are real professionals and firms that have been doing it for almost two decades through multiple cycles and making money. It's a timing point.
I think on top of that, there is one more aspect, which is what is happening in India. Once the NPLs have been recognized, underlying growth is there. And China, yes, it is slowing down, and it will slow down over time, and then again come back up. What we are talking about is still mid to high single digit.
It's still slowing in India.
And India is still mid to high single digit. It's like 6-7% compared to what we talk about, 0-2. Now you have here a demand for credit, and it is self-fulfilling because there is a growth, there is a demand for credit, there is a credit, there is a demand for growth. And that part is on top of the bank lending, which again currently is being fulfilled equivalent of whether you call it trust loan, alternative lenders, non-bank finance companies. But I think that will normalize. If you look at kind of over the hump outlook, overall, I think the banking sector, because they are government owned, will remain the bedrock and have to be for the capex cycle. And the non-bank would play on the margin on alternatives where the banks don't, which is consumers, real estate, regulatory issues in various countries on various sectors, and policy changes as they come along the way. But growth for both the sectors is definitely visible. And that is something that I think is different from Europe or the U.S.
So does that, going back to one of the points that Rob made very early on in the conversation, when he said that there are numerous markets out of there that are mispriced right now. Real estate was one of those markets that he pointed to. Are you saying that is not the situation in India?
No. Real estate market is mispriced? No, it is not. No, India is starved of real estate financing. The banks have a lot of restrictions on lending. And by definition, the real estate market has been kind of flattish for the last 5 years when the inflation has been there of even 5-6%, which means it is down in the real terms. But is it picking up again with the growth? Yes, it is. Now, China may have a different aspect to it, which probably
depends on what markets you're looking at. I think tier one in some tier two cities, clearly overheating is the correct description. And it, you know, prices have gone, you know, up so much last 12 to 18 months. I just cannot see how the yield or even the cash flow of some of these assets can be supported, supporting those valuations. But the question is, you know, for some of these cities, the investment demand is so high and there are very little investment opportunities for savers in China. Where can they use the money for? What can they use the savings for? I think naturally that goes into the real estate market. And it's the only market where investors have consistently made money over the last 10, 15 years in China, not in equities, certainly not in the bond market, but in real estate.
Well, doesn't this go back to one of the points, Rob, that you were making earlier on, and that is the Asian market is here, it's ready to be invested in, but there's still a huge amount of money on the sidelines. Now, isn't one of the problems of investing within this market is the fragmentation that we've just been talking about? These markets are so incredibly different. There are different regulations. You go back to the basics of languages. You know, there's different cultures. Investing in Asia is not as easy as going to the US and taking that big chunk of money or those assets and breaking them apart.
You know, I think that's part of the opportunity and absolutely part of the complexity of execution. So, you know, 70% of Asian credit is loans. So by definition, we only have locked up capital. We think there's absolute opportunity in illiquids, but we invest in liquid and illiquid markets, but the capital we invest in always is locked up because you take great advantage of everybody coming in and out of Asia, as well as buying into fundamentally being able to execute loans means finding the best opportunity. So you're absolutely right. It is still a, you know, relatively immature secondary and investable market, but that is also what's created so much opportunity as its absolute dollar amount and a couple of decades of really being able to prove how to do it.
Mm-hmm. So I have a question for you, because I'm actually going to do something novel and actually agree with you, that that the opportunity, I would say in global credit, but let's talk about Asian credit, is in the bank loan sector. That's a little bit like Europe. That's where most of the opportunity is. It's senior secured. It's floating. The problem, and again, we have had an allocation as big as I said earlier, 85% to Asia. The problem we have, though, which is maybe answering a question that you were asking, is that credit in Asia is much harder when the defaults do happen because of the perceived or real lack of sort of rule of law when you go into, you know, not an established bankruptcy code. You know, whether it's in India or China, by the time you actually have to start calling the lawyers, you're in big trouble. So the way that we have gotten over that when we have done our senior secured lending in Asia is only with banking partners, through banks where they don't have to rely on the judge or the jury to get the money back. They have sort of much more boots on the ground than we're ever going to have. So you're, I think you agree with us since you espoused it, that loans is the way to go, but you largely do it as a non-bank lender. So how do you deal with these defaults when things go wrong, when you don't have a bankruptcy code and a well-developed sort of bankruptcy system to defend you?
We actually do agree on this one. I would just say our addressing it is we become the bank. So you say you do it with a banking partner. So our platform in India is a controlled platform with 100% us and our two co-investment partners in there, and we are the bank. We have Sarfaesi law, and we write our own documents, which means, and we can debate this, but I think my colleague would agree, you actually, when you write your own documents, you can enforce. And so it's really contract law that is difficult in India. So our answer is we've gone one step closer into the market. We've created our own team. So, again, in China, we're in Chongqing, none of these overpriced cities, but in real China, 22 people who are sitting there, and we do origination, loan documentation, sourcing, and asset management. We are the bank, 100% foreign controlled. So I have all the trust. I'm not even trusting a partner. I'm trusting our own team.
But do they fear not repaying you like they may fear an HSBC or Standard Chartered?
Actually, they may fear you more, unfortunately. That's the truth. Especially in China or India, I think that's why the NPL ratio is 12%, and banks cannot do anything.
Why would they fear?
They have all the laws, but then you have not one bank with 70% market share. You have 27 banks who cannot agree to anything. So, yeah, borrower is divide and rule. So borrower, actually, when you have the same voice, you can get your answers, whether it is enforcement or it is civil litigations that you have. But if you have, like, no voice, then, of course, there is no borrower's voice.
So it's the bank's fault that NPLs are at 12%?
Part of it is yes.
They did do the loans.
Yeah. Well, that's true. That's true. So they can do something about it in India.
They are doing, and the regulator is helping. And there have been massive changes over time, last 7-8 years. I think one directional change has always been creditor-friendly. Political wind is more, I would say, lender-friendly today, which, because it's state-owned bank, again, there is intervention of politics. And it's a democracy, so everyone will have everyone, somewhere or the other, which essentially means the lending process may not be what you want it to be. So starting point is wrong, so of course the end point is wrong, right? Can the intervention change that? It is changing. And directionally, if you look at over the last 5, 7, 8 years, the regulations, process in court, outcomes are all creditor-friendly. And fortunately, they are more foreign-friendly, which is interesting, in certain countries at least. So, but again, I would still think that with all this, you can't ignore the bank. Do you want to work with them? Yes, but you need to control your destiny, which means you have your own sets of issues where you can enforce without them, because they may move very differently than what you would like to.
Okay. I just want to, at this point in the panel, let you know that in about 15 minutes or so, we will open up for questions. So just to give you guys a chance out there to think about, you know, I'm sure it's not every day that you have people like this sitting in front of you. So we'll open up in about 15 minutes. I didn't check that was okay, so I hope that's okay for whoever who's in charge out there. Anyway, the other thing that I wanted to do was change the direction of this conversation slightly. I want to talk about negative interest rates. Do negative interest rates work? Let's take Japan. Let's take Europe. I think the panel's leaving me.
So I'll take the bait. and Oriel's referring to a pre-conversation we're having. I can say this, since the title of this is, again, well, it was Credit Market Outlook. And I'm going to maybe sort of quote one of the few people in the world who's more intelligent than Larry Summers, which is Mike Milken, which is speaks to this, which is you're making a decision. If you're doing nothing, which gets you zero, or if you lend money for a long time that gets you zero, you're doing nothing, and you might be taking more risk. I cannot understand fundamentally why anybody, and there are allocators out here who did this, would Glencore borrowed at negative rates a couple weeks ago. Glencore is a company that was being written about, rightly so, in February, as a company that may be insolvent. And to go from insolvent to borrowing at negative rates, I mean, this is where I completely agree with my friends in the Asia panel. I don't understand why anybody would lend money to Glencore or most companies at negative rates, when in fact there are so many opportunities, whether it's U.S. middle markets or upper middle markets in Europe or many different things in Asia, that have real growth that are yielding sort of 4, 5, 7, 11. I mean, we're putting on loans at 11 or 12%. Where the ultimate ultimate risk is actually AAA rated companies. So, no, I don't think they work. And part of the grisly point of inflection that I was talking about is when either the markets wake up and realize it, or the central banks stop running the presses, which I don't think is happening anytime soon. So, actually, no, I don't think. When we talk about the Japanification of the rest of the world, but what's happened in Japan in the last 20 years hasn't been necessarily a model that we all want to aspire to. So, A, I don't think it works, and B, I truly think that those people who buy Glencore or any of the other sort of BBB companies at negative rates, I think, are actually failing on their fiduciary responsibility.
Is there anyone on this panel who thinks that they work? Negative interest rates?
I think they only create more volatility, which kind of makes it more, you have to be more nimble around it. Because with this rates in Japan, still people made money in Japan in real estate or in credit, but incredibly short periods of time, and it cannot be a strategic decision to put money.
So is that a yes?
No.
No.
Only opportunistic. You can trade in, but you can't put strategically allocations.
Dangerous precedent for the world, and that brings a more central bank question that does create real precedence. I think the point in sync with my colleagues on this panel really is that we all need to acknowledge rates are lower, right? But we think their risk-adjusted returns are still interesting. Frankly, a long credit, and if you stay locked up and look at private credit across the world, you have to be there. But you also have to, I would say, be frank with ourselves in terms of what is that rate of return that is, I think it's just, frankly, lower than it used to be.
So why are the big names out there? And when I'm talking about big names, I'm talking about people like BlackRock. Why are they buying negative yielding debt?
I think the key, a big key, and Rob hit his head on it, there's a big difference between private credit and public credit. And I think the world, especially since the global financial crisis, overvalues liquidity. What people are willing to pay for what I would say perceived liquidity, because by the way, that Glencore bond is liquid until it's not liquid. And then it becomes as illiquid as any of the stuff we're invested in. And I think that the good news for not only the folks on this panel, but most of the sponsors that we see on screen, it gets back to what the Arena Capital guy was saying, is private, it's changing in the U.S. pension system, but private credit doesn't fit into the nice box that most of the, you know, BlackRocks or the PIMCOs are sort of selling into. And let's hope that stays that way. Let's hope they put all their money into sort of Glencore at negative rates rather than our stuff. Because what the Arena Capital guy said, and I agree with, is when something doesn't fit into a box, there's opportunity. So what all of us do on this stage doesn't fit nicely into a box. The question then becomes, is there enough private credit out there globally or in Asia, these wonderful sort of NPLs that Rob and company are investing in? You know, again, maybe you can put 10 or 20 billion to work. The issue that BlackRock and PIMCO have is they have to put 100 or 200 billion to work. And the day that they start putting 100 or 200 billion into our market is the day that I'm going to be doing something else.
Do you agree?
I would agree with that. You know, it is still very early days in terms of the number of caliber managers that can put out money, and maybe collectively we have $10 billion, maybe even $20 billion across Asia, and that is nothing. That's a drop in the bucket in the $37 trillion market opportunity set. So, you know, boxes that are imperfect and undefined, we love them, right? And that creates great opportunity. I will say we are finding the pension funds, as I was saying, my first inflection point, really understand that and are working slowly, steadily, progressively to allocate increasingly from their fixed income bucket at the 2% world into the private credit, alternative credit, opportunistic credit, whatever they call it. Those buckets are growing. And they're not growing against PE. They're growing from their fixed income bucket.
As an Asia-specific manager, two Pan-Asia-specific managers here, how closely, and this is a genuine question, are you watching the Federal Reserve? How much does it really matter to Pan-Asian credit?
It matters more on the liquid, to be very frank. Mm. And I think I am worried about the liquid bond, high yield market today in Asia. High grade, fine, short duration, it's more about parking the money and preserving capital. But high yield, it's in the dangerous territory. Default rates are still going to increase. What is reflected in the NPL ratios of the banks may still go up. So then what we do is do private credit, and there, honestly, I don't worry at all. Whether the rate is 25 basis points up, down, doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter to you. How much does it matter in China, do you think?
I can't really comment too much about this, but I just want to follow up on what Sean said about NPLs and also default rates. So what we've seen in terms of default rates is it's been very low. In fact, you know, it's less than 2%. It's still, you know, well below the average for the last 35 years, even though, for example, in China, we have some really sharp deterioration in terms of credit risk in the last 5 years. And some companies are not really generating enough cash flow to service debt. What's keeping these companies from going, you know, tipping over really is liquidity. And liquidity provided to high yield issuers to refinance in the market at very low cost. And also investment managers are chasing deals for, you know, bidding down, you know, sending the yield down like from 10% to 5% or less than that for high yield. So high yield investment doesn't really exist anymore in Asia.
But the interesting question, and maybe you're probably one of the best positioned people to answer this. You're talking about liquidity of investors. And that's an interesting point. What Mike Milken sort of pointed out, I think, very articulately at his sort of LA conference was something interesting, which is in the last sort of half century, there's been a credit downturn. Sub-investment grade defaults have gone above 10%. I think it was U.S. rather than global, every 7 or 8 years.
Yeah.
But we're 7 or 8 years, we be worried. And what he pointed out was there's sort of two reasons why, in the U.S. anyways, there isn't, we shouldn't be worried yet. And one was maybe less liquidity of investors, although I think it's a point. What he pointed out was that free cash flow, the ratio of free cash flow to interest coverage is the lowest it's really been ever. And so it was not so much liquidity of investors than it was just liquidity of corporates. Mm. So that's a good kind of liquidity, because that tells me that maybe that 8-year cycle could go out 9, 10, 11 years in U.S. corporates. I think the other thing he pointed out is that the downturn in energy was, you know, as opposed to the previous two downturns, you know, subprime and dot-com, which were very broad-based, downturn in energy was mixed. It was probably positive for Asia, definitely positive for Europe, and positive and negative depending on the industry in the U.S. So my question to you is, liquidity of investors as the reason why defaults are low, very scary. Liquidity of corporates, not so scary. Mm. Where is Asia or Greater China on that spectrum? Because if you answer that question, then you're going to find out, A, where your point of inflection is, and B, how grisly it's going to be.
Okay. I think it's really the former, the investors' liquidity that's supporting some of these high, you know, high yield issuers. If you look at free cash flow as a measure, they have been persistently negative over the last couple of years. For a lot of the issuers, including some of the, you know, investment-grade issuers in oil and gas from China, some of the more aggressive M&A players out of China.
So, I mean, Rob is going to have a lot more NPLs to invest in pretty soon.
Yeah. The question is whether they, you know, the state banks will sell those NPLs to third-party players. But we're talking about very massive numbers that are coming out of the state system. So I am very cautious about liquidity, because if I just look at the default rates in Greater China, we have been holding steady at four defaults a year, and that's less than 3%. You're absolutely right. If you look at history, every 7 to 8 years, we have a spike in defaults, and with high, you know, spec grade default reaching 10% at every peak cycle. So we are not well below that at the moment. So I think we're just climbing. We're in a climbing stage in terms of a default cycle.
Rob, where are the opportunities in credit in the States?
Again, I keep quoting people, but what sort of the gentleman, Gordon Fyfe, what he said, and I agree with him, is bad is good. So there's sort of two or three reasons why, A, we like senior secured loans, and B, we like them through banks. One I already spoke about, which is when things go wrong, I get help. I get, you know, 200 or 300 people in their workout department that I don't have to pay for, which is fantastic. I think that the opportunities, as well articulated by Mr. Golub, is in the middle markets in the U.S. But unless you are either Golub or 3 or 4, maybe 5 other people who are big enough to basically be banks. I mean, once you have 20 billion, you have enough. I mean, if you have 125 people looking after some revolvers, you might as well be a bank. So for those guys, they're the exception. I think the opportunity in the States and in Europe to have senior secured loans is to team up with the banks, A, because they give you their origination, servicing, underwriting, and working out for free. But there's another reason which gets to the bad as good. Banks globally, but banks in Europe and the U.S. Are in trouble. And that's the bad as good part. So we're actually finding by working through the banks, not only do they help us cherry pick the good stuff, but in many situations, they'll actually subsidize our taking on this exposure. They will literally pay us a higher yield on a given credit than they're getting paid. Not because they're idiots, but because they have to be in that business. Because if they're not, you know, for example, they have to be in investment-grade revolving credit facilities. Because if you're not in the revolving credit facility, then you're going to lose the M&A business, the swaps business, the equity business, the custody business. So they have to be in that business. Under the new regulations, that's a very unattractive business for them to be in. So by teaming up with the bank, we'll say, look, we're going to take that credit risk off your hands, and the subsidy you're going to pay us, and it is a subsidy, is less than issuing equity. So for us, it is in the middle markets, and to a lesser extent with the larger, in those places where the capital, the new capital rules, the so-called Basel III capital rules, are the most ridiculous, where Dodd-Frank is the most ridiculous in its sort of over-regulation of banks, that's where we think the opportunities are, and which is why we think that the way to take senior secured loan exposure is by teaming up with banks. If you want to talk about whether this is a Clearwater Capital size opportunity or a PIMCO size opportunity, I would remind everybody in the audience that the top 30 banks in the world control $53 trillion in assets. And under the old rules, the Basel II rules, the equity to asset ratio for non-US banks was 2%. And under the new rules, I should have a slide up here like Milken always says, under the new rules, it's 10%. Basel III is 10%. So 10 minus 2, that's 8%. 8% times $53 trillion. The regulators in Basel III created a $4.2 trillion additional need for capital, and that's being dealt upon the very banks that lost $2 to $3 trillion. So going back to the bad as good, when there is a important sort of segment of the economy, the global economy, at $53 trillion, that's about one-third to one-fourth of the global economy, that has a, might not be quite the $7 trillion problem that are articulated, but when they have a $2 or $3 or $4 trillion problem, that to me is the opportunity in credit. Because if somebody really needs an extra sort of $2 or $3 or $4 trillion, that's when you get overpaid.
Okay. I'm going to open up to the floor. So is there anybody out there that has got a question for our esteemed panel? Gentleman over there.
Thank you. You've talked a lot about distress in Asia. I'm interested to learn more about it. Excuse me. And by the way, I cover the real assets manager research practice for Cambridge Associates. So I'm looking at distressed credit from the real assets point of view, which means real estate. Now, in China and in India in particular, let's talk about China first, then I'll talk a little bit about India. In China, you have four, basically, asset management companies from the big, you know, four policy banks, right? Can you get or buy loans from them at an attractive rate, or do you need to go through the local court auction to get that, right? And because of that, how big is that opportunity, right? That's on China. And on India, similarly, there are about, what, 11, 13 ARCs, or asset recovery companies, right? They're not allowing people to establish new ones. And these, as far as I understand, I may be wrong on that point, I'll let you address that. And a lot of these ARCs, right, they do have the banks as a minority shareholder. So what's the incentive for these ARCs to actually offload loans in their books at an attractive pricing?
I'll do Jenny.
So thank you for the sort of spot-on question. I think just for public information, you know, Huarong, one of the four big asset management companies you outlined, we actually have a joint venture, have been a member of one of their 14 subsidiaries. You can find it. It's a publicly listed company. And we, together in that balance sheet, it's a $3 billion U.S. dollar balance sheet with one of their 14 different subsidiaries. So the fact is, using that as a concrete example, there really are substantial $100 million transactions taking place today in the NPL space, largely on two counts. One, the banks who are doing note for asset sales, i.e., you buy this pool of $1 billion, and I'll lend you three quarters of the money, and you put up $250 million worth of capital. And those are taking place at, you know, I would argue, and we would believe, at relatively fair values. They're relatively scarce, and they're largely happening in RMB, domestically, and relatively quietly, but at attractive pricing, very similar to what we've seen across the world. That is taking place. I think the second thing that's taking place really is those organizations and our organization are doing non-bank lending. So they're replacing the banks, and the growth of small loan company licenses and other regulated entities really are replacing those banks, specifically in real estate, and doing classic developer financing. Because the regulations don't allow developers to put equity into the next project, they will pledge their entire building and all their sales to us. Let us borrow senior secured at 50% loan to value at 20%, because that's cheap equity for the next project. And there is the world's largest property market, quite a substantial amount of that. So there are, in real estate with hard assets, both, you know, not insubstantial NPL trades, as well as what I would think of as direct lending trades happening.
On the real estate, India is a very different story. The bank's exposure to real estate is fairly limited. It's by design. The regulator has been very, very anxious about capital market and real estate for a long time in India, since 91. Therefore, by definition, the NPLs of the banking sector in this segment is very limited. There are 15 ARCs at present. We own one of them. And that tells you that licenses are available. Actually, they are available on tap. People can put up the ARCs, because I think the government has realized if people, and especially foreigners, go and want to burn their money in India, be my guest, right? Because these ARCs in 8 years have been paid no dividend to any of their shareholders, forget about their banking shareholders, and have not done at all anything close to what the size we are talking here from Huarongs of the world. If you add up the total equity of all the 15 ARCs, I think it's like $400 million. You're talking nothing, right? But the NPL volume is $120 billion. The question is, will the state bank sell? The same question that he asked for China. Will the state bank sell? You only sell before first you recognize. That part, I think the battle has been won by the governor. The banks have recognized. Then it is a process to sell, which is, because you are government-owned, there is a supervisory and spotlight on you, whether you are supposedly giving discounts, whatever, right? And then third is there capital? Is there market there? Are there people who are willing to buy? And as I see now, I think the confluence is coming together where the sale will happen. There are buyers out there, mainly foreign buyers, because domestic capital is very limited for this asset class. But real estate, no. Real estate is all falling back into the non-bank sector where the biggest exposures are. And that is still in a growth cycle, in my opinion. I think currently the non-banks have, new non-banks have $8 billion balance sheet. Still some way to go before you see the NPLs.
Okay, great. Over here, Steve.
So are there non-performing opportunities, and are there examples of workouts where things have not gone according to script that either of you have had, and how it's and how they've proceeded?
You want to take first crack?
All the time. So one thing I can admit is nothing will go as per plan. Either it will be above plan or below plan. And NPL is a wild journey. It does happen. It's happening in India with few of our assets, and it happens in Singapore too. Or in other geographies that we invest in. Key is what skill set you bring to the table to find the solution to the problem that is addressed, and with the stakeholders, which are state-owned banks. So that is where the value is. It's not about enforcement. Yes, you need to have enforcement tactics. You need to have all the legal lawyers and whatever in your arsenal. But ultimately, what will boil down to is how do you meet the objective of a non-commercial lender and a workout situation where the borrower needs oxygen to rescue itself out. And that, I think that is where the art is. And I think that recovery process has been actually pretty good. Whatever I see of our situations, I think the worst case is you lose like 20 cents on dollar, and the best cases are where you make 4x. So that is the kind of risk reward we are talking about, where you enter in the NPLs.
I would just echo what he said. You know, again, five lawyers in our firm. We've been doing this for 15 years. There really is a restructuring track record that now goes back almost 20 years of absolutely executing this through the Asian financial crisis, through multiple different country crises. And you'd be surprised how good the legal enforcement tools are. It doesn't mean you want to use them just as it's difficult, but you really can find real examples of good workouts and actually, as Chris pointed out, better return profiles of distress in Asia than anywhere in the world. Defaulted public high yield, better returns than any other public market.
Yep. One more question here.
Yeah. Thanks. We've spoken mainly about private credit markets, so I was wondering if you had any views on public credit markets, and in particular sort of thinking about the hunt for yield and how that may all start to unwind and reverse in the Fed's tightening cycle. I don't know if you think a bit about that side of credit markets.
Paul, do you want to take that?
Yeah, it's easy. Short public credit markets. I'm actually not kidding. I mean, we're sort of raising money for four funds right now, so we're quite busy. But if there were two me's, one of them would go and do the following. We'd create a hedge fund that would take, you know, globally, whatever we can discuss, but would take senior secured loans, get that either with that 6 to 8% without leverage or 11 to 12% with leverage, and then take 200 to 400 basis points of that and just go and find every, and I don't want to beat up on Glencore, but every sort of negative rate Glencore out there that you can. It will probably take, now this is not, you know, a sort of the Big Short kind of opportunity, because it could take years, but that's why you fund your shorts through this this more enlightened sort of positive lending. But either through the interest rate or through the credit spread, the public markets, again, in Japan it hasn't happened for 20 years, but if and when central banks either stop the quantitative easing or they do something which, I'll finish where I started to quote Larry Summers, if the governments start doing what they should do, which is start doing fiscal stimulus rather than just monetary stimulus, that will cause rates to rise, and your floating rate long will be fine, and your shorts will really, I just think public markets, whether it's public equity markets or public debt markets, whether it's corporate bond markets, whether it's high yield bond markets, except for energy and one or two other areas, or government bond markets, public markets are mispriced, and they're mispriced profoundly.
We are out of time. However, I'm probably going to get into trouble for this. There's a gentleman over here that had a question. So let's just get to your question, then we'll wrap it up. Do we have a mic?
Just a real-world non-performing loan question. Hanjin Shipping has sneezed. Who's going to get the cold, and how bad will it be?
We're reasonably knowledgeable about Hanjin Shipping, have zero exposure, and intend to have zero exposure. I think it's a massive consolidation play. I think it's going to zero. And, you know, maybe you'll buy a few ships out of a couple of their secured ship things, and I think it's simply going to be an example of consolidation of overbuilt industries, whether it's steel, whether it's shipping. There's going to be it's just going to be absorbed by the current existers, and there's no good outcome here. I hope that the, you know, consumer cycle isn't hurt it seems like governments are trying to solve that one.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please help me thank our panel today.